guys, it's Sarah, and today I am back with a very popular guest, Lauren Whiteman. Lots of you have enjoyed the last interview that we did together, all about how to reverse disease in our pets, and we kind of ended up focusing mostly on dogs. So this video, by popular demand and lots of requests, we are back to talk about cats. And so, hi Lauren, thank you so much for joining the interview this morning.
Thanks for having me, Sarah.
For sure. So I will link the other video to this one when we are done so that people can go and reference the two. But maybe if you could give just a brief history about like your experience with rehabilitating cats, that would be a good place to start.
Sure. So I started on this journey rehabilitating myself, basically, just, you know, addressing a lot of health concerns that I had that were like lifelong health issues, just chronic disease and all of that. And at the end of all of that, you know, I discovered this like science of healing, basically, mm-hmm. and had so much energy and so much like vigor and you know, joy back in my life that I just felt like I needed some outlet for that. So I started to foster animals, and I started with senior dogs, particularly miniature schnauzers. I actually happened to be wearing the shirt today for the rescue that I worked with, Colorado Miniature Schnauzer Rescue. Nice. They're out of Denver, Colorado. And two wonderful ladies, Susan and Susan, they introduced me to this like world of foster and sadly this world of like very poor animal health and yeah. how our shelters are just constantly you know, just receiving these senior dogs that are just in terrible states of health, mm-hmm. and cats as well. And so I started looking into this and saying, like, well, like, clearly, if I can heal myself, like we know the causes of disease, we know the solutions, we know how to take a person from disease back to health. Mm-hmm. So we should be able to do the same with cats and dogs.
Right.
And so that kind of began my journey. And, you know, I started with the senior dogs, and then I ended up with a stray cat that ended up coming to me, just like wandered onto our property one day and wouldn't leave. you know, I started to just take care of his diet. And he came to me, I mean, he was just overweight and just a matted mess. Aww. And, you know, he'd clearly just been eating like kibble from around the neighborhood. and he had like bad skin conditions. His fur was really just dry and brittle. Wow. He would constantly have like bouts of diarrhea and just upset stomach and all of that. Yeah. And so we finally got him inside and put him onto the natural diet, because like when you're feeding cats outside, you can't control for everything yeah. that's going on. So we were feeding him the natural diet, but that he was still able to go and get yeah. kibble around the neighborhood and stuff like that. So yeah. as soon as we convinced him to come inside, which was funny. He just opened the kitchen door one day, and he just walked in, and he was just like, okay, I'm moving in.
That didn't take much.
No. And you know, my miniature schnauzers are like notorious cat hunters. Like they love to chase cats, and, yeah. and generally most miniature schnauzers do not get along with cats. So we had, at the time, I think I had 9 dogs in the house. At least eight out of 9 were cat hunters. So he just wandered into like Thunderdome. Yeah. so we, you know, but he stayed and was happy and, you know, so we just got it all figured out, worked with the dogs, and it was a great opportunity to teach the schnauzers to not be cat
yeah.
hunters.
Yeah.
And you know, we put them fully onto the raw diet, and, around the same time, just before he moved in, he brought us a kitten. Just randomly out of the blue. It was like 2 a.m. and he's out there like making all sorts of racket at our door. Oh, wow. And we go outside, and we find over by, like, there was a cement wall yeah. On the far side of the driveway, and he just kept directing us to it. And then we look over there, and there's just this little tiny ball of fluff, and we're like, what in the heck is that? And it was like a newborn, like, you know, a few weeks old. It was its eyes were open, but it was still very, very young.
Tiny.
And it was absolutely emaciated and just, you know, a bit like really struggling. Mm-hmm. So we brought both of them in, got them on the raw diet, brought them both up to perfect health. And, you know, that like just kind of progressed from just the dogs. And now we're, you know, now we're moving into cats as well. And so now I have 5 cats currently. And, you know, cats are not something that you adopt. They're cats like adopt you. They just kind of show up on your property. So, you know, we just kind of end up with them.
But the word spread around the neighborhood that you're a good place to show up.
Yeah.
I love that. Okay. So the elephant in the room for me anyways is cats are picky. They're so picky. Like I have offered my cat, you know, the natural, you know, chicken and chicken bone and all that stuff. She doesn't like it. So how did you do that? How did you introduce them to a natural diet?
Yeah. So it's funny because you'll have cats that will immediately take to it and no looking back, and they just, zooming onto it. And then you'll have cats that it's like pulling teeth and it takes you 6 months slow transitioning to get them there. So, and then you'll have some like everything in between.
Okay.
So what I thought was going to be hard was the older cat that, you know, we brought in all these health issues. I thought, well, he's going to be the one that's hard. And I thought the kitten would be really easy.
Right.
But it turned out that the kitten was already addicted to the kibble and the kitten would take the food and just throw it all over the place.
Play with it. But that's
play with it. Yeah. And then the older cat was like day one. He was just like, yes, this is great. I love this.
I don't
want the kibble anymore. So yeah, along the way, we've got our dog and cat Facebook group where we have thousands of members that, you know, are transitioning.
What's the name of that group?
It's called the Natural Dog and Cat Diet with therawkey.com.
Okay,
and you can find that on Facebook. If you just type in like the natural diet, it should come up for you, or therawkey.com, and it should come up for you. So we've had, you know, cats from all extremes to transitioning. So, Ruby has some thoughts about that.
That's Ruby. Great.
Oh, here's
an animal topic show, so we're happy to hear the noise. Oh,
here's one of my kittens. This is Tiny Kitten.
Tiny kitten. I love it. Yeah. Nice. Yeah. So some take to it, some don't. So what is your, well, first of all, maybe you can explain the ideal diet for cats, and then how to start transitioning them.
Yeah. So our ideal is going to be what's as close to their natural diet as possible. And, you know, what we focus on is not only what is natural, what's going to most closely meet the natural physiology of the cat, but also what is affordable and what is, just generally available in the grocery stores. You know, it's all well and good to do things, you know, as you would do them in nature, but, you know, most people are, you know, work 9 to 5 and they need things to be workable. And so, you know, so we're looking at like, okay, well, what's the best sources of things that we can pick up easily at a grocery store anywhere around the world? Uh-huh. So when we look at their natural diet, cats are true carnivores, which means that they exclusively eat meat. They do not eat fruits and vegetables. They do not require fruits and vegetables. They do not eat grains. They do not require grains. Okay. So when we look at the commercial foods, we'll often find that they're adding to like meat byproducts. They're adding grains and they're adding fruits and vegetables and all of these things that cats don't need, have no use for. They don't have the physiology to digest. And so that's just creating this massive waste that the body has to deal with. Okay. So what we're looking at is what is their physiology and how can we most closely meet that? And so what we've basically come upon is, you know, whole chicken is going to be your easiest option at the grocery store.
Okay.
So that's what our primary food is. So with my cats, we feed about 90% of the time we feed whole chicken.
Okay.
And we want to feed whole because, as you mentioned before, in the bones, cats do need bones. They need bone with just about every meal. They can get away with the occasional meal without bone, but they do need consistent bone with their meals, just like they would eat it out in nature.
Mm-hmm.
They need organs. And so when you buy the whole chicken, there's generally the organs inside the cavity that are in all chickens. And then usually you can get what's called the giblets. And that's just the liver and the heart and mm-hmm. gizzard and usually the chicken neck. So in most grocery stores, you can get a whole chicken with gizzards and with the giblets, you know, the
everything
whole organ package.
Everything that you need in one package.
Yeah. Yeah. The only thing that you're not going to generally get is like the head and the feet.
Right.
But not a huge deal.
Yeah.
So, you know, you're getting a nice, well-rounded product. You're getting all the bone in place that you need. Uh-huh. So you don't have to do a lot of thinking or trying to like supplement or anything like that. Yeah. You've got everything there that you need. So that's where we go with our primary. And there's a few things that we do to make it a little bit more suitable, which is in nature, the prey that cats are going to be eating is going to be things like small birds, mm-hmm. Rodents like mice and rats, and bugs. And mm-hmm. so all of these are very low fat. They have very little fat on their bodies.
Okay.
And so when we get a grocery store chicken, because they're generally fed a diet that is not natural, they tend to have much more fat on their body. So okay. one of the things that we do to counteract that is to trim off the fat and to remove the skin. Because so we're taking off, just trying to get the fat off as much as possible. Just get the fat down on the product, because in nature, they're going to be eating those very lean and low fat prey. And so their physiology, their liver, their organs are designed only to process small amounts of fat in small quantities. So we don't want to overfeed them on fat. And that's really the biggest disease cause in the commercial foods is the quantity of fat that is in those foods. Because when the commercial processor is making the food, they're not taking a whole animal and grinding it up and putting it into your cat's food or your dog's food. What they're taking is the meat goes to the for human sale, so they trim off all of the you know, the breast meat or the various you know, portions, and then what's left over, the bone, the gristle, the cartilage, and the fat uh-huh. is then a waste product, and then they take that waste product and grind that up, mix in a bunch of other ingredients, and that becomes cat food. So they're starting with a product that's already higher in fat than the natural diet. And then they're concentrating all the fat with the bone and the cartilage, and then that's what's being fed. And so that's why we're seeing this really chronic epidemic levels of disease, because we're starting out cats from day one on a product that is an extreme excess of fat and is also cooked and processed and contains a bunch of other additives that they don't need. And so it's just kind of a compounding effect.
Yeah. Yeah. Food colorings and probably even like, I don't, like you said, grains and carbs and whatever makes it, you know, kibble like.
Yeah. Them. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Gotcha. Well, that's really good. So, a question comes to mind about so you pull apart the chicken, and are the bones too big for most cats, or should people be looking for like a Cornish hen?
So you can feed Cornish hen. That's perfectly fine. The Cornish hen is a bit more expensive. Cornish mm-hmm. hen is just a young chicken. So it's just a much smaller bird. Mm-hmm. With a whole chicken of standard size, like it's, you know, typically you're going to find a 5 or 6 pound chicken mm-hmm. in the grocery store. The cats can eat all of the bones, but they might leave behind a small section of the drumstick in the center. My cats, we just take a whole chicken, portion it up into their serving sizes, and use all parts. And then usually what I have left over is just about maybe an inch long section of
the thickest part.
Yeah, it's just basically the most dense part of the bone. Yeah. And then usually my dogs just come by and clean that up for them. They're just like, oh, we'll take care of that for you.
So no need, unless you have a cat like missing teeth, no need to actually buy a meat grinder and grind the chicken and the bones up together.
Correct. Yeah. If you have a cat that has dental issues, you know, either they're missing a lot of their teeth or they have like a sore mouth or something like that, you can use the grinder. But generally, we want to avoid that as much as we can, because they actually get quite a lot of mental stimulation from chewing on those bones. They also, it also strengthens their jaw and their teeth in order to chew on those bones. So it's actually essential to keeping their teeth healthy And that's why we see on the kibble fed cats that they lose their teeth or they have the mouth inflammation over time. And by the time they become seniors, they have very few teeth left and lots of dental issues because they're not getting that exercise of the jaw. They're not getting that.
The cleaning of the teeth when they're.
Yeah, the cleaning, knocking the plaque off.
Yeah.
And it, you know, it's like I always explain to people this way is, you know, if you look at osteoporosis, the doctors always recommend strength training for elderly people. So once you hit a certain age, they say, do your strength training. And that's why use it or lose it. When we use our muscles, so if we use our jaw muscles, the body's going to bring in more blood flow to the area, which is going to bring in more nutrients to the area. And so they're going to be supplied with those minerals that they need to rebuild the teeth. So when they're chewing on that, that's what's happening is basically they're working it. They're getting that workout of the muscle, which is bringing in the blood flow, which is bringing in the nutrients, which is then, you know, building the teeth back up.
I love that. Okay. So you mentioned portion sizes. Can you give us an example? Like, I know I could go to Walmart right now and get a what they call a young chicken for $7 and they have a 2-pack for $11. But let's just say one chicken, one cat. $7. How long would it take a cat to eat that chicken?
So it's going to depend on the cat. Like, you know, just like us humans have different portion sizes based on our activity level. So the person who sits at a desk all day and gets no like cardiovascular exercise is going to need far fewer calories than the person who's running a marathon.
Right.
You know, cats are the same way. You're going to have older, more sedentary cats that require less food. You're going to have younger cats that are crazy athletic and get access to outside all the time, and they're going to need more food. So we always give a general recommendation of where to start, and then we adjust up and down based on the needs of the cat. So generally what we start with is anywhere from 4 to 7% of their body weight. That's generally most cats will fall within that range. Most of my cats are either 6% or 7%. My cats are pretty highly active. We have an outdoor cat pen with tree branches and all sorts of activity centers for them to play on. And then they have cat towers in the house. And so they're quite active for cats. So they tend to be on the little bit higher side. I have had cats in the past that were as high as 10%.
Wow.
But that's a little bit more rare. We found that the majority, probably, you know, 80 to 90% of cats are going to fall within that 4 to 7%.
Okay.
So, you know, usually what we recommend is starting somewhere in the middle, 5%, 6%. Yeah. And then if they start losing weight, you drop it down. If they gain weight, you would lift it up. Reverse that.
Yeah, I understood. So to dumb it down, just because, you know, we haven't done this before. So would you say you literally take this chicken, you peel the skin off, you trim the fat off, and then you chop it up or pull it apart into chunks, and then you weigh those chunks? Well, you weigh your cat first, you weigh the chunks, and you figure out how much of that chicken is 5% or 6% of the weight of your cat. And then that's their entire day's amount.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's going to be the, for the day. And so we generally feed one meal per day.
Okay.
You can feed twice a day if you want, but, both dogs and cats are binge and fast eaters. So they're, what they would do is they would have a prey kill. They would stuff themselves to maximum and then, you know, try to finish that prey. And then they would fast until true hunger returned. So, you know, if they had a big prey, true hunger might not return for 3 or 4 days.
Right.
You know, and then they might have days where like a cat might get like a giant rat, and then that's going to fill them up for 4 or 5 days. And then they'll have other days where the only thing that they catch is crickets. And, you know, so they might eat a few times in that day, just catching bugs. Okay. So, but, you know, because we're feeding generally like one large portion, we're going to feed one meal per day. That gives them the best digestion for that, because everything's, you know, instead of stopping and starting digestion, everything's happening all at once. So we generally feed one meal per day, and we incorporate a fasting day randomly every 7 to 10 days.
Okay.
And then we utilize more extended fasting for health conditions. So if a cat comes to us with some sort of disease, then we'll incorporate 3 to 7 day long fasts to help the body get through those healing events and things like that. Yeah, exactly.
I love it. Okay. Now I know a lot of people would probably be like, oh, I don't want my cat to choke, so let me chop it up with like a scissor that can cut through bone. I'm assuming your recommendation is to not do that, or what's your thought?
Right. Yeah. So the one thing we want to do is first of all, we always have to remember that this is their natural diet. If they were out in nature, they would catch prey and eat it whole, and nobody would be intervening and nobody would be cutting it up or anything like that. So first things first, we have to trust them to know their own abilities. Yeah. It's like, you know, it would be like you as a grown adult, you know, going to eat your salad and, you know, somebody coming over and saying, oh, let me cut that up for you.
Yeah.
I don't think you can
shred it up.
I don't think you can determine how big of a piece you can fit in your mouth. So right. let me fix that for you. So that's the first thing, is it's like a mental hurdle that we have to get over, because it's only natural that we want to be like in control and like feel like we have to make it smaller for them or whatever. But the downside to that is actually you can create a situation of danger by cutting it up, because if you give a cat a piece that is whole and large, they're going to gnaw away at it and they're just going to break little teeny tiny pieces of bone off that they can swallow easily.
Yeah.
But if you're using, say, a cleaver or scissors or something to chop that bone up, you're going to be cutting it into pieces that may or may not be small enough for them to easily swallow. So if you miss a piece and you get them something that's a little bit too big, it can get stuck. Yeah, it can get stuck in their throat. Gotcha. So we always want to give the largest piece possible. So with my cats, most of our cats eat between 4 ounces and 7 or 8 ounces. Uh-huh. So I try to cut pieces when I portion the chicken. I cut like 2 ounce chunks or 3 ounce chunks, and then, you know, I'll give them a few pieces here and there. And then I'll take like a chicken heart or liver or something like that, to, you know, get to the correct portion.
Okay.
I want to give them something that's maybe roughly the size of a deck of playing cards.
Okay. Gotcha. And when you mentioned the livers and organs, is that part of that ounce total?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So with mine, you know, say I'm making meals, like I have 5 cats. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take that chicken. I'm going to take the skin off. I'm going to trim the fat as best I can. I'm not going to go crazy, but I'm just going to try to get as much of the big chunks of fat off with the scissors. Yeah. I just use a regular like kitchen shears for doing that. And then I'm going to split the chicken down the center, take off the wings, cut it into pieces that are roughly about this big,
a deck
maybe.
Of cards.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, deck of cards. And so a piece of thigh, I'll cut into 2 or 3 pieces.
Okay.
A drumstick, I'm going to cut into 2 pieces. Breast, I'm going to cut into 3 or 4 pieces.
Okay.
And so, you know, I'll just cut them up into these little chunks. Just try to take off as much of the fat as I can. And then I generally put it all into one container, and I make enough food for each day. So our cats eat about 30 ounces combined for all 5 cats. Mm-hmm. So I'll have like a container of 30 ounces. And then at the time of feeding, I have just a small kitchen scale. You know, you can pick them up on Amazon for about $10.
Yeah.
Just your standard digital kitchen scale. I put their food dish on there, and then I grab a couple pieces of chicken that have been cut up. I grab like an organ or a chicken heart or whatever, and then put that in the bowl. Get like Tiny Kitten is going to get 4 ounces, okay, and then Pepper is going to get 6 ounces, and Annabelle's going to get 7 ounces, and you know, just lay them out like that.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
Okay. One thing, just to 100% make sure everybody knows, we are talking about raw. Raw. Don't cook your chicken. Don't cook the bones. Don't feed them cooked at all.
Correct.
And the cooked bones are super dangerous, but the raw is natural and they're okay. Right.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. And like, so cooked bone, the reason that cooked bone becomes dangerous and the reason that people fear chicken bones is because, a cooked bone has been chemically altered so that it's not digestible. Mm-hmm. So when they, you know, a dog or a cat is going to naturally be attracted to it because it does still smell like meat and bone, but it's not going to be digestible. So they're going to crunch on it. They're going to break it. They're going to make sharp pieces. Yeah. And then those sharp pieces can get stuck in their digestive tract. They can cause obstructions or cause perforations and all that. So we always want to be very careful to keep cooked chicken away from cats, away from dogs at all times. But the raw is fully digestible. Okay. And what ends up happening is it goes in as bone and it comes out as powder in their stool. So, they break it down completely. You should not see any sort of fragments of bone or anything like that.
Okay. So even though they might swallow a chunk of bone that looks sharp, you don't have to worry.
Exactly. Yeah. They're going to, and with cats, chew it much more finely. Like with dogs, they tend to just like chomp, 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 swallow. Mm-hmm. Like they don't do a whole lot of chewing. Cats tend to do a lot more like gnawing because they have really tiny little teeth, very sharp, tiny little teeth. Yeah. So they'll gnaw on it. So, you know, my cats, if I give them a piece of, like say a chicken thigh with the bone and, you know, it's about the size of a deck of playing cards. Yeah. That'll take them 15 minutes or 20 minutes or so to sit there and gnaw on it. So they're not just like chomp and swallow. Yeah. Whereas like my dogs, if I give them an entire leg quarter, it may take them like 2 minutes to eat because they're just like chomp, this is small enough to swallow, chomp, this is small enough to swallow. Yeah. So with the cats, there's much less risk of them choking. The only, the only real serious concern is if you're starting to chop things up small, because then you're setting it up to a point where they could choke. So always best to stick to the big pieces.
What about those parts of the chicken where there might be just like a really tiny thin piece of bone? Like I feel like I've seen one of those off of like a drumstick before, like a real tiny thin piece, or maybe like a rib. That's safe too.
Yeah, absolutely. Sometimes like you'll see like on the breast meat, you might see like the chicken ribs or something like that are really thin, or the neck bone is really thin. It's also very soft. Any of those like really thin bones tend to be very soft. So yeah, they're going to just digest that no problem.
Okay. It sounds like your cats eat their meals pretty quickly. I have had a question about like, I'll just switch over to my dog as an example. Some days I will give him his chicken and he eats it right away. Other days he's just apparently not that hungry and it'll sit out for hours and hours, but then later he'll go eat it. I'm assuming they have enough stomach acid that he's fine. I mean, he's never gotten sick from that, but is that okay? Or if you're finding like you're transitioning your cat or dog onto this, do you find that you just give it to them for like 20 minutes and if they don't eat it, put it back in the fridge?
So in nature, they would actually like bury their prey and, you know, they're going to dig a hole in the ground and stick it in the ground. And that's kind of gross to us, but to them, it's perfectly normal. They don't have refrigerators.
Right.
So their system is completely designed to handle all of that. The dirt, the debris, the bacteria and all of that.
Watching and sitting out for hours.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And, you know, and the reason that humans that, you know, we are so concerned about salmonella from the raw chicken is because we are not physiologically designed to eat animal flesh. So we don't have any of the internal chemistry designed to process this, but our cats and dogs are physiologically designed. That's why they have those sharp canine teeth. That's why they have the long incisors to puncture skulls
and a shorter digestive tract, right?
Yeah, that's why they have the shorter digestive tract. That's why they have the much stronger stomach acid. They're completely physiologically ready to handle all of that. Okay. My personal way of handling things.
Yeah.
So I would say that if a dog is not finishing their meal consistently, like if it's just like a one-off thing, that I wouldn't really do anything. But if they're consistently kind of leaving their food, I would bring their portion size down a little bit across all of their days, just because they are telling you that they're not really hungry. Okay. And, you know, it's people underestimate how detrimental it is to overfeeding our animals. Okay. So, you know, a lot of times we see, you know, people, we go to the dog park and all we see is these, you know, fat and overweight dogs and cats and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And so it becomes normalized, but, you know, it really does significantly shorten their lifespan. They are meant to be lean and muscular, not square and blocky. Okay. So, so I would say that if it's a consistent issue, it would be worth just cutting the portion back. You know, an ounce or two difference can make a big difference. And especially with the cats, what I've found is that if we start overfeeding our cats, they may not gain too much weight really quickly because, you know, it's only maybe an ounce difference. Mm-hmm. But if I give Tiny Kitten 4.5 ounces, she can get really cranky and she starts to swat at the other cats and she starts to get a little bit. So you'll start to see some behavioral issues if we're feeding them a little too much. Then I bring her down to 3.5 and she's like a perfect little angel and super sweet. And she doesn't get, you know, feisty or anything like that. And I've noticed that with all of my cats. You know, it can be a challenge when you have 5 cats managing, figuring out exactly how much to feed them. So we kind of tend to swing back and forth a little bit. And sometimes we'll go a little too far. Yeah. Like I had brought pickles up to 9 ounces at one point. And while he's so active, we didn't really notice any weight gain in that time period. I'm sure if we had left it for like a year, he probably would have had noticeable weight gain. But what we did notice was he started to get really cranky and nasty and he was swatting at the dogs. And he's usually like very sweet. So we brought him down to 7.5 and immediately the behavior stopped.
Yeah.
And so we were like, okay, well, you know, that's a 9 is too much for him. So now he's like 7.5 to 8. So, so that would be what I would suggest. And then in terms of like leaving the food out, I would just say, I will leave it out for a little while, but generally I just end up sticking a lid on it and sticking it in the fridge. If it's been
trying again later.
What? Yeah, but that's just my personal preference just because I have so many animals in the house. I I don't want somebody else overeating or just causing a fight or anything like that. If one dog sees it and the other, you know, they fight over it or something like that, I obviously want to try to avoid anything like that. So
if you have lots of animals, maybe it's a good idea to put them in their kennels or cages while you're feeding and then let them out after they're done.
Yeah, and I generally recommend feeding in kennels. Uh-huh. Period. I think it's one of the best ways to handle, especially if you have more than one dog. If you have, you know, just one cat or one dog, then, you know, it's not a huge deal, but it does help you with keeping things neat and clean. Like you don't really want your cat dragging its raw chicken across your couch or anything like that. So you set up a nice little feeding zone, have a crate, put their food in the crate. But when you have more than one animal, it can create stress. If the one animal eats slowly, the other one eats fast, you might have them trying to steal, or just it creates stress in terms of like, are you going to steal my food? So by having them each in their own crate, they can relax more. And so they don't feel that stress. And so they're going to digest better and they're going to assimilate all their nutrients better if they're not stressed when they're eating.
Gotcha. Now I know that you have an appointment, so we could definitely cut this, stop now. I guess I just have one last question for someone that's wondering, can cats live on chicken alone, or should they be trying to go to some store and buy mice and, you know, other kinds of birds and I don't know, you know, or is it okay to just do chicken forever?
Yeah. So I do think that we should have some variety over time. You don't need a whole lot of it. You don't need to be getting like the mice if that's not something you're comfortable with, but giving them just a little bit of variety so that they are getting nutrients. With the dogs, it's not quite as important because they're getting most of their nutrition from their fruit meals. But with the cats, because they're only getting meat, we should give them a little bit of variety. So like I said, my primary is going to be the chicken. Mm-hmm. I feed that for probably about 90% of our meals. But then what I do is I look at the grocery store for the clearance rack and I see whatever they've got on the clearance rack. I try to look for things that are lower in fat so I don't have to do a whole lot of fat removal, because some of the stuff you'll get is just really fat laden, and it's going to take you forever and you're wasting so much money on that. So I look for things like beef stew cubes, pork chops, turkey. Pork chops portions of pork or whatever, pork loin, whatever is usually my grocery store. They'll have, if you go really early in the morning, they'll have like their clearance section that they clearance the meat that's supposed to be like close to expiration day.
Are beef ribs safe also?
Yeah, with the beef ribs and with the, like, I don't like to feed a whole lot of the larger animals because you think in nature, like a cat is not going to feed. Yeah, it's not naturally going to feed on a cow, but I will do it on occasion just to give them a little nutrient variety because there are slightly different nutrient profiles in each different meat. What I usually get in terms of beef, I'll get like beef heart, beef liver, and beef stew cubes, because those are the three things that I found that are not really crazy loaded with fat. And I just give them like a small piece. So if I get say a beef heart, I'll cut it into strips and I'll cut like 1 ounce cubes. And then I'll give them like a piece of chicken and a 1 ounce cube of beef heart, just so that they get a little bit of variety. I do really like to feed them fish. I mean, fish is a very much in alignment with
With the bone, though.
Whole with the bone. They can eat the head and the tail as well. Okay. Although some cats will leave the head behind. Some will eat it. Sometimes they'll start out leaving the head behind and then eventually start eating the head. So, you know, you can just play, let them decide. If you can get, you can get really small fish like smelt and sardines and, like anchovies and things like that. They always need to be raw. You don't want to get like the canned anchovies, anything in a can has been cooked and cooked at high temperatures. Okay. So, you never want to feed your cat like canned tuna fish. Like people do that all the time. Feed canned tuna fish. That's like one of the worst things you can give to your cat.
Really? Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Cause it's very high in fat and it's cooked protein. So it's just unusable. And then a lot of times they add oil and salt to the can as well. So, lots of problems with that. But, the only other thing I would say is, turkey, chicken, duck, rabbit, just same guidelines. You just want to try to remove as much of the fat as you can. Look for the meat options that have less fat. Mm-hmm. If you're concerned about, like in some areas, I know in the UK, you can't buy the whole chickens with the giblets. Mm-hmm. So a lot of times you'll have to buy those separately. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so most grocery stores will sell like trays of chicken hearts and trays of chicken liver and mm-hmm. gizzards and chicken necks. So you can usually find a place to get them supplement if you're finding that your meat is not mm-hmm. available. The other thing is if you find that for whatever reason whole chicken is not available, your store only sells it already portioned. Mm-hmm. That's perfectly fine. Just look for the things that have bone in it. You don't want to just buy them chicken breasts and just feed chicken breasts. You got to make sure they're getting that bone, get the organs. You can order online things like frozen mice and, they also sell like day old chickens that are, baby chickens that fed for cats.
Okay.
There's a whole line of all sorts of different things. But the one thing that you want to avoid getting is anything that's been ground. So that includes mm-hmm. if you're at the grocery store, you never want to buy ground turkey or ground beef because they're grinding in tons of fat into that. And then also you're not getting the bone. When you order the stuff online, same problem. Like they might, if it's a pet specific raw food, but it's being sold ground, they might have the bone in it. Like they might have a rabbit that's whole ground, but they're not going to be taking off the fat. And so you're going to end up with an issue with that fat building up over time. So stay away from the ground, keep it, whatever you end up getting, make sure you get it in a way that you can see the fat and take it off yourself.
And if you were giving them like a chicken thigh and the thigh's got a pretty big chunk of meat, don't cut up the meat part. For them, just let them just gnaw on it, right?
Yeah. Like if you have a 7-pound cat, you might give them a whole thigh, and mm-hmm. you would just, the whole thigh is about 3 to 4 ounces, depending on the size of the chicken. So, you just give them the whole thing. Okay. If you needed to cut it in order to make the portion correct, you needed to cut it in half to make 2 portions of 3 ounces or something like that, perfectly fine. But just always try to go for the biggest piece possible.
Gotcha. Okay. Well, I have to respect your time. I don't want you to be late for your next appointment, but this has been awesome. So you guys, when you're watching this, if you have questions, definitely leave a comment. I read my comments and then we can circle back around and do most questions asked kind of video and get those fine details answered for you as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Come back and do like a Q&A video if people are interested and, submit us a bunch of questions and I'm happy to go over them.
That's awesome. Okay. Thank you so much, Lauren. And again, you can find Lauren at therawkey.com and her Facebook site one more time.
So it's the Natural Dog and Cat Diet with therawkey.com. And at both the website and the Facebook group, you can get a free feeding guide. We have one guide for cats and one guide for dogs. So whichever animals you have, come get your free guide, come, hang out in the group, and you know, we just have tons and tons of free information. I'm on there every day answering people's questions. So, if you have an animal that's got a chronic disease and you're not sure how to begin, or you just, you know, you need a little bit of handholding or a little bit of extra guidance, I do offer consultations. So you can book those on my website if you need a little bit more help with your animal.
That's wonderful. I'm so glad that there are people like you out here, Lauren, helping all of us. And it is an epidemic. So truly grateful for you. Thank you so much for your time today. And yeah, have a wonderful day. And we'll circle back around with another episode later.
My pleasure. And thank you so much for having me.
Bye.